today the topic is, that we chose, is what Hashem wants from us. Not in general. In general, we made many lectures about it. Now, in these days, specifically these days, in the last few weeks, the things that are happening to our Kehila, to our place, to the Jewish nation in general. So we have to speak about some of the messages that Hashem is sending us, which sometimes we're not even paying attention. But before that, before we started the lecture, we spoke about this Gemara. I just want to finish it, that when Hashem told Moshe to write the Torah, he arrived to this Pasuk, and the Pasuk said, let's make a person in our image. It seems to be that more than one is speaking. We all know there's one Hashem. The Torah repeated it many, many times. I'm the only one. There's no one before me. There'll never be one after me. Above the heaven and under the earth, there's no other God. And many other examples. But here it says, let's do. So we know by looking at Torah Shebe'al Peh, we know Hashem is consulting with the angels, even though he does everything in the end by himself. But Moshe said to Hashem, why to write plural? If you write plural, many people will make a mistake. It would confuse them. They think there's more than one God, Chas v'Shalom. And the answer that Hashem gave is, Arotze lit'ot yavol ve'it'es. Someone who wants to make a mistake will come and make a mistake. And from here we learn one very important thing that I've seen throughout the years. And it's so true. You see it all the time. You have two kinds of people. You have people that, you know, they're really ignorant, they don't know. So because they don't know anything, they're making mistakes. But you have people, and this is the majority, that they already decide what they want to do. And now, to justify their way, they start searching for the mistakes. If a person searches for the mistakes, every time you give him an answer for his question, he will find something right away, a new one. It will never end. It will never end. Why? Because the only way he's going to relax his conscience if he has an open question, pending question. As long as the question is pending, I can continue with my pork. I can continue with my Chilud Shabbos. Why? The rabbi doesn't have an answer. You understand? It's a famous story by one of the rabbanim that he was coming out of the shul with his talmidim. And one of the talmidim that dropped out of yeshiva already became completely non-shomer mitzvot. So he was walking towards the Rebbe and he got scared. You know, he's seeing his Mechal Shabbos. So right away he came with a massive attack of questions. Rebbe, you know, I have this question, it bothers me very much. So after he hears this question, the Rebbe said, very good question, I really don't have the answer. So he said to him, Rebbe, I have another question. He asked another question. You're right, I don't have the answer. It's very good kashya. I don't have the answer. Then he asked a third question, and he said to him, you're right about this as well. I really don't know. So he told him, Rebbe, you're playing games with me. When I was in yeshiva, any question someone ever thought about, right the way you came with the answer. Now I ask you three in a row, you don't know, something is fishy here. So he told him, you're right, you don't really have questions. You have excuses. You want to justify your way. So what's the point of wasting time giving you answers? Any answer I give you, come up right away. This is not an argument for the truth. I'm not giving my time for nonsense like this. You understand? So this is it. This is what the people do. They choose and then. Now I want to start basically our topic for today in the book of Iyov. Iyov. Lamed Hey, 35. You can see later. This is what it says. It's Pasuk 6, 7. Vav and Zayin. Im chatata matif albo. Verabu psha'echa mata selo. Im tzadakta mati tenlo. Oma miyatcha ikach. Did you ever read this verse before? This Pasuk? I'll repeat it again slowly. Im chatata matif albo. That's period. Verabu psha'echa mata aselo. Im tzadakta mati tenlo. Oma miyatcha ikach. The Ramban used this pasuk when he comes to prove that many people sometimes think that Hashem needs me and my mitzvos. Tzar HaShechina, Hashem is upset that a Jew makes a scene, Hashem is crying when a husband and wife getting divorced, so he's really upset, he's taking it to his heart, he's really crying, he's not in a good mood today because there was too many tragedies, you know, all kinds of things like this. You cannot say that it's not written in the Torah. Tzar HaShechina, it's an expression that everybody knows, that Hashem regret that he created the world and he wants to restart it, all kinds of things, that it's really human. It's human traits, it's not divine traits. The answer to that in general, I can go more specifically, the answer to that in general is that Hashem speaks to people in the language they understand. None of these things is real, which means you don't understand, don't try to understand it literally, that really Hashem is sitting upset for this and that, or is happy today, or what you do is changing anything in any way. Of course not. It's only, and Hashem doesn't have an arm, Yad Hashem, and he doesn't have a nose, Charon Apo, Harapi, doesn't have a nose, and doesn't have a real chair. What do you think, he sits on a chair? You know, do you think he really has tefillin? Like the Gemara say, what's written on a tefillin of Hashem? Do you really think Hashem is an image? Many times the Gemara says Hashem appears as an old man. Hashem appears as this. Hashem appears as that. So since Hashem is kol yachol, he can do whatever he wants. If he wants to appear to someone in an image, he will make an image. What's the problem? If he wants to go back to his original, he doesn't have a dmut. He has no image, no size, no color, no shape, no time. He's not subject to any time or anything like that. But when he wants to appear as an old man, he appears as an old man. If he wants to appear as a light to all the dead people, what do they see? They see a big light, huge light. The people who died and came back to life, they described that they never saw such big, strong light, and it's not blinding you. The light is so strong that you're able to look into it. Today, even a little flashlight someone puts, just a few days ago, we didn't have electric. The kids are playing with their 1 second, the light in your eyes, you cannot see. Over here, you're talking the biggest projector you can ever see, and you can look into it, and it's not blinding you, and also you are very attracted to this light spiritually. So what is it? Does it mean really Hashem is this light? Hashem wants to appear now in this position, in this situation as light, and over here in this world, as you know, with all this Meshalim, parables that the Gemara gives, and that's it. But the point is that it's a very big mistake and a common mistake that a person thinks that Hashem needs him, that he really needs his mitzvos, that he's really doing Hashem a favor, that, you know, that now because we're correcting the world, etaken olam b'malchut shaddai, like the time of the Mashiach, is going to come and correct the world, that it really makes Hashem more complete or more perfect. Chas v'shalom, this is on the border of being a kofer. If a person thinks these things, then Hashem needs something from me, that without me putting tefillin or davening shachris or saying shema morning and evening, that chas v'shalom, he has some kind of a limitation because of me. This is mamash kfirah. Ma. What other words you can find for it? So that's why you have this pasuk in the Tanakh. And this pasuk saying, now let me translate it. Im chatata matif albo. If you make a scene, you did not make any impression on Hashem. Matif albo. Didn't affect him in any way. Verabub sha'echa. What's the difference between im chatata to rabub sha'echa? What's the difference? Im chatata, you did not make any impression if you made a scene. Verabu psha'echa, you have lots of crimes, lots of sins, right? Rabu psha'echa, ma ta'aseh lo. It really looks like the same thing, different language a little bit, but looks like the same thing. What's the difference between chatati, aviti, pashati? Chatati means not intentional. Ignorance, I didn't know it's not allowed, I didn't know it's Shabbos, I didn't know, I thought it's allowed, I thought it's kosher. That's called chatati. Aviti means, avon, means on purpose, bemezid. I know it's not allowed, but I said I had to do it. I wanted to do it. I can regret a minute later, but at the time that you did it, it's bemezid. And then, chatati, aviti, pashati. What's pashati means? Not only I did it on purpose, I did it in order for Hashem to get angry. I want to do it to get Hashem angry, like on purpose, not only because I have a taiva or I have desire for it. I don't even have desire for it. I actually prefer glatt kosher beef than pork. Why am I eating pork? Because the rabbi is sitting in the table next to me. I want to get him angry to show him I can care less about the religion. I'm not a part of you. I don't want anything to do with you. That's called pashati, poshea. So here it says, im chatata, if you make a not intentional sins, you did not make any impression. You may think, okay, that's because it wasn't intentional. Or maybe now, when I do it on purpose, b'mezid, maybe I do make a damage. We see, we read in the Gemara that a person that makes chet, any kind of sin, is mekalkelet olami. Right? That's why Hashem said to Adam HaRishon, make sure that you're not going to ruin my world, right? You have to watch the trees. He gave him this whole thing. Where is this Gan Eden that Hashem is talking about to Adam HaRishon? Can you locate it in the world? Where is this garden? Now, by the way, you should know that in this parsha, you have maybe, if I remember correctly, at least 30 words that connects to gardens in equal skip, in codes, hidden in this text. More than 30. Chita, Seora, Gefen, Hadas, all the things that grow from the ground, trees, all kinds of names of trees, all of them appear in this page in equal mathematical skip. Many, many words. Oh, Zayit, Rimon, Teena, all appears in equal codes in one page. In this pasuk, in this parasha that speaks about that Vaita, you know, and that Hashem puts Adam to be in charge of all the trees. He told them, you know, you have to watch the trees. What was his job? Well, Hashem created him to be a farmer? What was this whole thing about? And plus, where is this place? From the parasha you read that it's somewhere in the world. That Gan Eden, there's like a physical Gan Eden. Where did he put him? He put him in Olam Haba? No, he was with the body. No, he puts him in the body. So he was somewhere in this world. Where? In Brazil? In Uganda? Where was it? In Iran? In Eretz Israel? You don't find this place. Place with the rivers, the splitting, the description that appears in the Torah. What is this, a mashal? Maybe it's an analogy, b'chlal. So the answer is very simple. It was a place like this in the world, exactly as the Torah described. And the whole world was one continent. Only one Yabasha and one ocean. That's it. And then after the Mabul, it broke, as the Zohar say, to 7 pieces. Now remember, this the Zohar is before Columbus discovered America. They already knew 7. Right? So it says in the Zohar that after the flood, this continent, the one, broke into 7 pieces. Now, in 1870, there was a scientist, Goy, German, named Wagner. Sounds like a Jew, but he's not a Jew. And he only lived 50 years. He lived from 1870 to 1920. That's all. And one good thing he did in his life, he discovered something that helps us to prove that exactly what the Zohar... We don't need him to back up the Zohar, don't get me wrong. But for the secular people, they need him. They believe him more than believe Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. What can I do? So, you know. So it says, he says that the world was one continent. It wasn't a Kabbalist. And he said the world was one continent and broke into 7 pieces. And he made a research that he showed like a puzzle where each continent was connected to the other exactly, like green, white, green. You know, you give the kids 7 pieces. How do they know how to connect them together? Blue, green, brown, yeah. So they put it, so you know, so it show exactly. You see this piece, for instance, let's say 150 kilometers, and over here 150 kilometers, we're connected right here, green and green, and desert and desert. And in the end, it shows you how the world was one piece. Because the world broke to 7 pieces and everything shifted to different places and the flood changed the entire place, you don't find the world the way it was. Up to the Mabul, there was one way the world was, and after that, it's a different world. It changed geographically. There's no Kashia, nothing whatsoever. And what's the proof? For those that come to make a claim that the Torah was given by a person, it's not divine, what person would make a story and a place like this doesn't exist in the world? What, is a fool? He's trying to convince the people that God gave him the book. And so why is giving them a place that doesn't exist? It's like me saying, you know, God gave me this book and he told me that this is the way he made the world, and he put Adam in this place, and this place doesn't exist. So the people will tell me, okay, let's go and find this place. Prove to us that this place exists. Well, the place doesn't exist in the world. If I'm a faker, I would choose a beautiful paradise somewhere in the islands and see this is where Adam was, and describe it in my book and say that's where the world started. I'm not a fool to write something that doesn't exist. Everybody right away throw tomatoes in my head and say, get out of here, it's not from Hashem. So obviously, you gotta use your head. So let's move on now. In the last few weeks, as you can see, one gadol after the other is passing away. Mamash, every week something is happening. The biggest yeshiva in the world is in a deficit of $20 million. The Mir Yeshiva, they announced yesterday after the Rabbi Finkel passed away, they're on the point of going Chas V'Shalom bankrupt. The situation that we had in the last 2 weeks, like HaKadosh Baruch Hu put us 4, 5, 7 days, depend who, without electric. There was no hot water. Nobody can function. Everyone was depressed all week. And the question is, it seems that really nobody think that is the hand of Hashem. People get angry at the electric company, call, scream, cares, getting angry all day. What's going on? Outrageous. It's a conspiracy. They're doing it on purpose. It's because of that Hasid who got electrocuted. They're taking revenge. Everyone built a whole thing in his head. Who to blame? I didn't hear one person say, wake up. Hashem is very upset with us. We worry about our chulent and our bellies and all kinds of chandeliers and things, and we forgot already what we do here. At water, this, the mikveh, $5 million mikveh, if not, the women would maybe not want to go. What's going on here? Is this what, this is what we came to the world for? And Hashem, every once in a while, he wake us up. It started with this little boy, Libby Misken, in the Borough Park. And I once spoke about it, I think even here, that there's one thing to take, this, that a psycho take a kid and kill him, lo aleinu. Shoot him, stab him, choke him, whatever. Shem irachem. But the way he killed him, it was a very strong message from Hashem. What is this? Cut him to pieces, throw the leg in this garbage bag, throw the head over here, put the rest in the soda. What's going on here? When did you ever hear such a thing in history? You don't hear things like this. Definitely not in a Jewish world. Something like this, that one Shomer Shabbos will do it to a boy from the entire community in the most religious neighborhood perhaps in the world, that has probably more religious people than any other neighborhood in the whole world. What was the message? And I said, the message is none of us is a Navi, we don't know. But Hashem wants us to use our head to guess. What does he want from me? Maybe it's this, maybe it's this. Now, I may give 10 options. One of them is the truth. Sometimes two of them is the truth. Sometimes all of them is the truth. It can be a combination of many things. Since I don't know, my obligation is to make tshuva on each one of them. You know, oh, maybe this is the one. Maybe this is the one. Why it was cut to pieces? The answer is because we have no achdus, no unity. This group and this group and this group and this group and this group. You know, so, I mean, the things that I hear, how many people's life are getting destroyed in the marriages because of racism in our own from community? It's mamash take away the desire to live. We just lose the desire to live when you see what happened to innocent bachurim and girls, all kinds that wants to get married, and the families with all their, all kinds of negative thoughts and averos that they have in their head, destroying their life. No, you cannot marry him because he's from a different town. We are like this. He's a different minhag. This is like mamash, like two, like different nations. Sometimes it seems that between us, we are more prejudiced and racist than between the Jewish nation to the other nations, which means it seems that if the boy would come with a Japanese girl and want to marry her, his parents would cry 3 days. But if we bring another Jew from a different culture, they'll cry 30 days. That's what it seems like. It's a disaster. So Hashem said, let's take an innocent Ola, Korban Ola, cut him to pieces like this, to show you that the nation of Israel is one body. No, it's not. One is in a garbage, one is over there, one is in a suitcase. They're all separated. This is the message. Otherwise what? Just to shake us with the tragedy, he could have just killed. We will be shaken up with this tragedy very much. But the actual things that the crazy person takes him and cut him and put all kinds of places, shake up the entire place, this is one message. The electric, as we see, Hashem wants to wake us up. Life is not a picnic. The Ramchal wrote, this world is not for actually being here. It's a preparation for the real world. The real world is the place where you're going to get the reward. If you're not going to do what's necessary, you think this is the place of life, like most people do. Now remember, I'm not talking secular people. They have no idea what they live for, Bichlal. So what do you complain to them? Everyone think, you know why the Jewish nation suffers so much? Because 70% live and act like goyim. That's what most from people think. And that's why some of them even hate the non-religious people. Some of them very nasty to them. Some of them say, because of them we're dying, because of them we're suffering, because of them Israel will be destroyed. They come with lots of accusation. But I'm telling you 100%, there's no doubt in my mind that they are responsible for 1 or 2%, and we are responsible for 99% of the situation of our nation. And I'll tell it to you with the common sense. Common sense, Hashem has more than us. If we can reach it with our common sense, for sure Hashem can also reach it. What's the common sense? A father that has 10 sons, nine of them are bums on the street, never went to school, don't know how to read, don't know how to write, don't know anything. All day in the street, they're doing the worst thing you can think of. From very young age, and he has one who goes to the best yeshiva in the world, has the best education, great, genius, midot, ashkafa, the best melamdim. And then the one reach, I don't know, age 18, and begins to make averos also. Slowly, slowly, change his clothes, change this, tefillin, not tefillin, davening, no minyan, kosher. Ah. Who does the father is more upset? The nine in one side or the one in the other side? Who really upset him, break his heart? The nine or the one? Should never be in this situation. Of course the one. The one. You're the only one I have. From you I expect. From them I don't expect. What I expect from this boy? Age 6, they threw him out of yeshiva, and then another yeshiva and another one, they destroyed him. Yeshiva can be paradise, can be Gehenom. Depend which yeshiva, depend who's the Rosh Yeshiva. For some stupid thing that the boy did, he destroyed him. There was a story about one boy. Guess what he did in yeshiva? Guess what he did? He never believed such thing. He was upset at the way his Rebbe is behaving to him. When they all went on a break or after the school, I hope I remember the details, this many years ago I read that story. He came into the yeshiva and took all the sidurim, all the gmaros, everything, and threw everything on the floor. And they came the next morning and they saw everything, all the Torah, everything is on the floor, all the sidurim, all the chairs, everything. First thing they thought, Arab vandalism. They do it, the Arabs, imach shimam. They come, they go into the yeshiva and they do things. They spray, they do all kinds of things. So right away, the police come, this, that. After the investigation, guess what they found? It's one of the boys from the class. Now, a boy like this has a chance to stay in yeshiva today anywhere in the world? Or his life is over? What do you think? His Rebbe, Rosh Yeshiva, did not throw him out. Not only he didn't throw him out, today, for one little word, I saw a kid that was a very good learner. His father used to tell him, let's learn the parsha. He was in maybe 13, 14. ninth grade actually, beginning of ninth grade. A week before it happened, the mashgiach of that yeshiva, one of the better yeshivot, called his father and say, the father asked, how's my son doing? He told him, Bli Ainara, if he's going to continue to learn like this, I have no doubt that he will be a gadol beYisrael, will be somebody very big. A week later, the same mashgiach called up his father, please come take your son, he's out of our yeshiva. What did he say? He say, what the, not the real world, the other world, that even the presidents and all the important people in the world are saying every minute, nobody cares about it. He say, world, you know, it's not covered. One time he said they warned him. Second time somebody told about him that he said it again, they threw him out. Should see that boy what a criminal he is today. You look at him, you cry for a week. What became out of him? I was on the way to be one of the gdolim. It's like murdering kids one after the other every hour in our community, and people don't realize. All over the world, not only here. Here, Israel, there, Europe, one after the other. Why? Nobody wants to be mechanech. They want to come, do the job, finish, get their paid, and go home. Nobody has patience. He doesn't have patience for his own children. You want him to have patience for 30 kids learning his place. Now, of course, I'm not jumping to conclusion. There's a lot of great places and melamdim, they're wonderful, they give their life. Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem for them, should kiss their hands. I'm talking in the rotten apples, the damage that they make. So, you know, we see what's going on here, that you put your son, which is, you know, he needs to work with him. You see what's happening today. You're much getting scared. You say to yourself, you know what? Maybe it would be better off to lock him in a box to stay Am Haaretz, but at least he won't go to places that they do all kinds of things to him. And what happened to the community? The community don't know how to act in cases like this. They don't know what to act because right away, first thing they think about Chilul Hashem. If we talk, everyone will talk, it's going to get to the all over, it may make it to the news, it makes us look very bad, which is really something to consider. But on the other hand, nobody thinks about how many other miskenim will ruin their life in the future by hiding the truth. And the truth, one way or the other, always comes out. This is the way Hashem made the world. It comes out in the end. And when it comes out, it's a million times worse than when you try to hide it. It becomes much worse. So the situation right now is that our education system is going down. There's very, very big problems with drugs. Today I spoke to a kid from Brooklyn. I asked him, he's not a kid, he's 23 years old. I wanted him to teach me a little bit about drugs, because everywhere I go I see people who use drugs, everywhere I go. And even Shomer Shabbos kids who wants to become Balei Tshuva, they already get feeling, they start to come to Daven, they Shomer Shabbos, they don't stop with this. So I told him, tell me, what about this drug? I want to know what's going on, how to convince these people to get out of it. So he told me, 10 years ago when I was in yeshiva, we had 320 kids in yeshiva, maybe 250 were using it every day nonstop. Like, in yeshiva? 10 years ago, today is much worse. I want you to know, when I was a kid, we're not talking Baruch Hashem, this great yeshivot, that is very strict, you don't find these things, but when I was a kid in my school, which wasn't anything near the schools you imagining, was a zoo. The school was a zoo. The zoo is better than the school that I've been here as a kid. There was one kid, eighth grade, smoked a cigarette. I'm not telling you a lie, 100% this is how it was. And he got caught hiding somewhere and smoking a cigarette in eighth grade, 13 years old. And the entire school for 1 week did not stop talking about it. Did you hear what happened? All the parents, everyone don't want to send their kids to school anymore. Make sure you stay away from this kid. Everyone was afraid to talk to him. When people used to play soccer in a school, he used to show up, he wants to play, everyone runs away. You come play, like the head of the mafia. What was his crime? Smoked a cigarette. If only people would imagine that 30 years later, what an epidemic we'll have in our community. They would think it's a joke, what I'm telling you. The teachers were afraid of him. The whole city, everyone knew. He used to call him Ploni Avarian. You know, Avarian means like a gangster. For what? Smoking a cigarette. It's stupid to smoke, but to make him the biggest criminal. I want to read to you some of the words of the Rebbe from Rata that described the situation better than you can imagine. But before that, I just want to finish. The Ramban say that these psukim are teaching us that all these expressions that we have, nachas ruach, sadness, tzar ha-shechina, it's only expressions for people to imagine what Hashem is thinking about us, but really not that he's now happy and he's smiling and now, and this is all expression, is speaking to us in a language that people can understand. And let me read to you some of the things that he said about the days that we are in. You know, today they said on the news that December, in England, they published one of the newspapers, that the plan is that in December, Israel will attack in Iran with the help of England and United States. It's a United States, I don't know what does it mean, a strategic help. I don't know what it means in the army terms. But England and United States will supply the strategic help and Israel will do the attack. Now, if people think the Iranians are stupid, they are dreaming. The Iranians are not Arabs. They are very clever and very sneaky nation. They always been, and now they are developing all kinds of scientific things. They developing their own missiles. They developing their own computers. They're not a foolish nation. And they already say that if they will be attacked, they will shoot 5,000 missiles to Israel with the help of the Hezbollah and others. And what the Arabs will do inside Israel, all these Palestinians, we don't know what's going to be. Maybe Gog Magog will start in 3-4 weeks from now. And we are thinking, we have electric, we don't have electric. My son got 95 on a test. Why I didn't get 100? Maybe next week there will not be anything anymore. The whole world is is moments before the big explosion, like the Navi spoke about. Let me read to you some of the words that he says. He says, like, by the way, you should know also the autistic kids are panicking. When they communicate with the neshamot of the autistic kids, they talk in such panic about what's about to start happening any minute. So it's really, really scary. And if we're not going to do something right now, when are we going to wake up? When Chas v'Shalom, we're going to find out tomorrow in the news that that's what happened? And now, to do something before the decree materializes is much easier than after. After, it will take a million times more efforts and it won't help. So this is what he writes. There's no doubt that we are before a third world war that is about to start any minute. It's 100%. The Rebbe from Rata, the Shomer Emunim, you know, the Mishomrei Emunim. Here is his picture, right here. Yeah, here, right here. I don't want to show you the Russia underneath. That's why I brought the picture up. You know, so this is it. It says like this. There's no question we are 100% in front of a third world war. The last prophecy of the prophets is Malachi. Navi Malachi. He said before Biat Mashiach there will be Hashem will screen the middle. We spoke about it in a lecture about Mashiach, which Baruch Hashem was a very good response for it. He says that there will be screening the middle, as we've seen in the last 20 years, and then will be a war that nobody ever saw from the time the world was created. War like this never took place. Now, you know, in the World War, 100 million people died. Not only 6 million Jews, 100 million people died. Such destruction. I was in Belgium, I was walking in Antwerp, and I see buildings, like some of the building is one shape, and the rest is in different color. I say, what's this? So no, that's the Nazis bombed this area. They bombed this whole area, so they fixed the buildings. You know, some of the building diagonal, it was all broken to pieces. They rebuilt from the floor that it got damaged, they rebuilt it. You look around, you see what damage it makes in cities, civilized cities with thousands of people walking every minute there in these areas. This is in a primitive war. There was no chemical yet, like now, chemical bombs, and no atomic bombs. So it says like this. It's obvious that this is going to happen. The prophet never said anything from his own. It's all what Hashem told him that's going to happen. But a moment before it will happen, we won't know that it's about to happen. A moment before. Which means a person will be 9 o'clock in the morning, is getting ready to go somewhere, and 9:01 it's going to start. There was not going to be any preparation. Boom, in 1 second the news will be out. A disaster happened. And then one thing leads to another, you know? And it says like this. It says like this. All we need is one crazy person will take a plane and break into the Vatican, a terrorist attack, or into the mosque over there in Jerusalem, and see what's going to happen in the whole world. It says like this. The Abarbanel wrote books about Gog Magog war and the days of Biat Mashiach. One name Mashmiah Yeshua, one name Matzmiach Yeshua, and one name Mayaneh Yeshua, like the hospital in Israel, Mayaneh Yeshua. This was 600 years ago. 600 years ago when there was no bullets. No bullets in a gun. Bow and arrow, spear, swords, that's what they had. What did they have in those days? And he wrote like this. It says, when the nations will see that they cannot win, they're going to mass destruction weapon and will destroy the world in moments. The Gaon Mivilna says the last war will take 9 minutes. This was also 250 years ago when they had dust, they had powder that they put in a gun and shoot one time. And put powder, you know, with a horn, every 15 minutes they shoot a bullet. You understand? So in a generation like this, to write that the world will be end in 9 minutes, looks very, very weird, no? Where are you bringing this hallucination from? But we know that everything they say is based on a Navi. So it says like this. He did not know what atomic bombs are, the Abarbanel. There's no atomic. But he described an atomic war, that the world will be over in moments. It says, even 50 years ago, it was not Shayach. There was no understanding what does it mean in moments. Now everybody in the world became religious. Before, the Hashem said, before the Mashiach come, Hashem will throw hunger in the world. Not hunger for bread and water. Hunger to search for Hashem. But it's not only by the Jews. The Muslims, everyone become fanatic. Christians waking up now. In America, they're waking up to religion. They made a survey, 70% of them believe in life after life. Believe in heaven and hell. Believe in all these biblical expressions. Believe in God, believe in many things. The whole world is waking up all of a sudden. So he says like this, I'm calling the Jews who live in the exile for many years to return back to the Holy Land. That they will have a place where to hide when the time comes. I don't know what he means. According to the Nevuot, in Eretz Israel is not going to be a picnic at all. I don't really know. In Zechariah 14, it describes what's going to be in Eretz Israel. It's very scary. I guess what is going to, the Navi also said that there will be a big salvation in Eretz Israel in the end. And Behar Tzion Tiye Pleta, right? And those Anisharim, Ikaru Kadosh, Anishar Vetzion, Ikare Kadosh. But who wants to go there to hope that he's going to remain there in a place of Sakana, right? But I guess that the rest of the world will be a much bigger place of Sakana. Now it says like this, the whole world is getting slowly, slowly, you know, we all understand that there's a war now between Esav and Ishmael. And in the end, they're going to make a covenant, an agreement, and turn against Eretz Israel. And this is how the Navi describe it. There will be massive amount of world tragedies, earthquake, tsunami, one after the other. This was given, this conversation was before the earthquake in Turkey. Since then, they had another one, 18 buildings collapse, you know, yesterday. Yeah, and probably there will be more. Remember in 2 weeks ago in a shiur, I told you there will be more. Very simple. It's very very obvious that Hashem is starting to shake the world. Shaking the world. You know, up to now, you know, when you have a chicken with lots of feathers that went in the sand, it's full of dirt, you got to clean them one by one. It takes forever. Up to now, Hashem was cleaning it one by one. You don't feel. Now it's all in one shot. It's all over. Everywhere you go, it becomes dangerous. The antisemitism in the United States is in a sharp rise. If you see the radio shows every hour in the United States, people are calling every hour. I put it in my, I sent you an email. Sent you an email, listen to it. People are calling to destroy the Jews, to kill the Jews. Mama speaking on the radio, not hiding their opinions, getting on the news. So far, the hosts are most of them pro-Israel or pro-Jews, or they just don't want to lose their job, you know? But in the meantime, you see more and more people are speaking. Now, you have to understand, it's not that they didn't think about it before. There's one thing that when you think about something and you're embarrassed to talk about it, and then one person comes and he brings another one, and the next thing, there's 50 people, and then 500 people, and they begin to do riots on the street. The next thing, the government surrendered. If they see a million people standing and screaming, what do you think they're going to do? Do you remember what happened in Crown Heights 20 years ago, something like that? For 3 days, the blacks did riots in the Chabad, Jews, and the police was standing for 3 days doing nothing. With Mayor Dinkins, the mayor, giving the police instruction not to move. That's what happened. And the hate then was all because one Jew, you know, there was something with a car. So by mistake, it was an accident because of that. Now, imagine what's happening right now in the world. So the question now is, we have to ask ourselves, what Hashem wants from each one of us? If we're not going to change, then there's going to be another one, and another one, and another one. Everyone will be more painful than the other. How long we have to receive these punches until we're going to wake up? How long? How long more? Did it stop the Lashon Hara since all these previous tragedies? I don't think so. Did it make people learn more Torah? I'm not sure. Did it make people give up materialism, their addiction to material? I'm not so sure. Did it make people better husbands or better wives or whatever the case is, or better fathers or better mothers? I'm not sure. Does people really understand that it's time to make tshuva before we lose it for good? Forever, because that's it. There's no more chances. This is the final step. You either chayav or you either zakai. Where are we heading to? So, you know that the Gemara gave us this example that in these kind of days there will be only one thing that can save a person. We spoke about it. Torah and Gmilut Chasadim. Torah alone is not enough. Gmilut Chasadim alone is not enough. A person must be busy every day with Torah and Gmilut Chasadim. There is no point of worry about your financial future anymore. It's the Atzat HaYetzer HaRa. The Satan is telling you how you're going to marry your children in 10 years from now, 15 years from now. Most likely won't even get to that time. One way or the other, a person should not worry about the future too much because Atal noten lahem et ochlam beito. Hashem gives the parnasa when he needs the parnasa.
Chazon Ish said should only worry for 2 years.
Chazon Ish said worry for 2 years, that wasn't a month before the world is coming to an end, you know. In time of the Chazon Ish, but still we were not in a situation that the world is in. Even the Goyim, I promise you, all of them begin to understand that the world is coming to an end. I get more and more emails from all over the world from people. How long do you think the world has left based on the Torah? The Goyim ask. The Goyim understand. Hashem begins to put it in the mind of everyone. Now it's the final step. People are worried. I'm going to go to college 7 years. I'll be a doctor in 10 years. in the end, it comes on the expense of Torah. He doesn't have time for Torah. He doesn't have time for this. Doesn't have time for this. We have to now understand, we are in a very critical situation. Many speakers speak about it in the world. Does it make the right impact on the people? I doubt it very much. I hope I'm wrong. I hope it does. Not everything I know, of course. But from what I've seen, I don't see the shuls pack 10 times more people in the learning. I don't see the yeshivas are growing. I don't see, we see Balei Tshuva all the time, but how many from Jews going off the derech? Anybody has the statistic? Almost every family has at least one victim. Everywhere you go. Some comes back, Baruch Hashem, but many does not come back. Do you know that half of the Knesset are from birth that left the derech? Do you know half of the people who speak in television use expression from the Gemara, which shows right away they used to be in yeshiva? Chilonim, regular chilonim, do not know this word, nafkamina. They use expression from the Gemara. You see that they used to learn Gemara up to a certain age. The most famous people. We should ask ourselves one question. If there's so much tshuva, if the religious family has an average 8 kids, and the non-religious family has 2 kids and a dog, or 2 kids and 3 dogs, and sometimes 1 kid and 4 dogs, but not really, generally 2-point-something kids. So that means the religious community is growing 4 times faster. Add on top of it all the Balei Tshuva. In 20, 30 years, the majority of Israel should have been Shomer Shabbos. So how come it's not the case? Agudat Israel, 50 years, 5 mandats. Aguda. The Ashkenazi under Rav Eliashiv, 5 mandates. What is 5 mandates? 150,000 votes.
Most Haredim don't vote.
No, they give them orders to vote, and every 4 years, the same 5 mandates. Same thing Shas, the Sephardic movement, 10, 11, same thing all the time, already a few times in a row. They're not growing. Should have been a lot more. The answer is, nobody thinks about it. What makes the secular side growing is the religious side. We create chilonim for them. And every family, 1 or 2 goes off the derech, become chilonim. Some of them are very anti. Many of them are from birth. They're not even embarrassed, some of them, to say. I used to be. They're showing you a picture. I want to tell you something. One time I went to Brooklyn. And time is running out, so we have to give time for questions. So, one time I went to Brooklyn, I gave a lecture, everyone was not religious there. I see one Yemenite, chiloni, no kippah, no nothing, sits there. See, it's full of poison, full of hate. You know, these people, they don't let you have a normal lecture. They're angry, they speak from the heart, it bothers them. Then, through the argument, he was talking against the rabbis, against the yeshiva, against this, against this. I was giving him very strong answers. So all of a sudden, one woman there said to him, "Show him! Show him who you used to be! Show him!" He got up a picture from his wallet, which is very strange. He kept it in his pocket. I right away realized what's happening here. He took the picture out of his pocket. He gives me his picture. I see black hat, Yemenite. Beard, simonim like this. He said, "This is me." I look at him. Yaakov and Esav. Same person. I said, "What happened?" He said, "On Shabbos, my father used to lay on a couch." Look at the stupidity of us, what damage he can make. "And used to tell me, 'Learn, learn, read.' And he used to fall asleep, and every few minutes he opened up his eyes to see if I'm learning. And then as soon as he falls asleep, of course I don't learn, I was a kid. So he caught me. A few times he caught me not learning. So he took a rock, and he tied it to my beard, took a band-aid or something, and he tied it to his neck, to his beard, that he won't be able to pick up his head, because it's a heavy rock. So his head will be down. He said, 'Now you won't move your head from the Gemara, even if you want.'" That's why he's ready to kill the religious people. So I said to him, okay. I said to him, now I understand. I'm wasting my time. It's a personal matter. It's not that you think the Torah is not true. What are you talking about? He was trying to show that it's nothing personal. No, I'm speaking against the Torah. So I said to him, let me ask you a question. If you're such a big shot, why you carry a picture of your days that you used to be righteous in your pocket? Because you miss these days very much, right? After all, the life where you live right now is worse than the Gehenom, huh? Guess what happened? He got so angry. I saw in 1 second, he's jumping and he's going to beat me up. Now, in those days, I'm talking to you maybe 12, 13 years ago. I didn't have a laptop. I had a big overhead projector, heavy. You know those big projectors that have an arm that they show light on the wall? And I had a package of overhead transparencies. I have a book. I have a few things. Right away I say, Chacham enough berosho. In 1 minute it's going to give me a punch in front of everyone. I start to put the things in my head. I took the projector and I started to run. Started to run in the middle of the lecture. He didn't realize because everyone was arguing. Then I hear from the window, I'm already downstairs in the street, and the one who invited me to the lecture is running after me. Where are you going? Then I hear this Yemenite guy scream, "Efou! Where is he? I'm gonna kill him!" I ran quickly into my car and I ran away. This is the damage that we sometimes do to our children. We're not that stupid, maybe like that father. But we create. And you should know one thing. All the kids have questions they're afraid to ask. If they know once or twice they ask a question from the Rebbe, they'll say, oh, the Apikores. Yeah, Meshumad, dangerous kid, be careful from him, he's asking questions. The system is not set to answer valid questions. Human being, normal questions, not a crime to ask. If you don't let them ask when they 10, 11, 12, 13, this is normal question adults have in their mind. Forget about them, adults. If you don't let them take it out of the system, later when they become independent, it becomes a big problem, a growth. It's growing and Hashem Yirachem, one or two problems, personal, it goes, it's the opposite. The system should give the answer because we do have the answer to every question. Something must be changed. The question is, do we have time left to change? I don't know. Maybe we still have time to change because to change it takes years. I'm not sure. But I wanted to say to you now, based on what the autistic kid's saying, based on what the rabbis say, based on what we see in the Nevi'im, time is very limited now. And Hashem is sending a strong message. If not now, you may miss the train. Those who want to hear, very good. Those who want to continue to sleep, dafyomi, this, business, that, Manhattan, selling diamonds, meeting the goy, here, there, everything as usual. No rush, no nothing. Now it's the time for more tzedakah, even though there's no money. People don't make what they used to, because soon you won't need money. You're not going to know what to do with this money. There's more tzedakah, more chesed, more yosher. No gezel, no stealing, no cheating, no interest, emuna, strong. This is the things that will save us. If this not, we're not going to do it. Amen, anili mili. If I'm not going to take care of my neshama, nobody will do the job for me. You understand? Some people will pass it, but after very, very much and big amounts of suffering, they suffer very much. Some will, chas v'shalom, be destroyed in seconds, immediately. And some will make it easy, but very few. We are not tzaddikim. We are maybe benonim. Let's face it, maybe benonim. Benonim is going to have a very hard time. The question is, are we going to have enough Torah and gemilut chasadim? Do we show Hashem that we care to save others? This is a very key point here. Key point. If you show Hashem that you care about other Jews to save them, then your chance to get saved is tremendously higher. You can be a firm Jew, but egoistic. You keep everything. You make sure your kids keep everything. But you really don't care about what's happening out there. I know one person told me that his brother lives in Bnei Brak, and he locked his children in the apartment. They never went out to the street. School, home, and that's it. Not one time he allowed them to go on the street. You know, so why? Because he was trying to keep his children not to see the secular kids in the neighborhood on the street. There's all kinds of people in the street. It's not a ghetto. It's open. You have there people, chilonim, walking, goyim. So I don't want them to see anything. Yeshiva thing. But does he care the same thing about the other kids? Didn't bother him that the other kids are on the street. The question is that we have to understand, yeah, this is my son, but every kid is my son. Every kid is my son. Every kid is Hashem's son. This is his son, this is his son. He's better than him, he's better than him. What makes him better? If you care to save others in any way you can, your chances to get saved is much higher. You don't care about others, promise you. Don't be very surprised that you come to the judgment day and you say to Hashem, I kept Shabbos, I did Gef Tzedaka, I ate kosher, every day Koveh Aitim, Tzipiti Leishua, I never stole, you know me. What's the problem? Yeah, but you didn't care about any other Jew. You didn't really care. When you hear that two guys died yesterday on the way to Lakewood or Connecticut in a horrible accident, how many people sit and cry like it's their own son? How many? Maybe the parents of the boys and few from their class, maybe. The rest, 2 minutes later, back to business. One time I saw a very interesting thing, and then we finish, one last minute, that many times we get envelopes. Kupa this, orphan, a husband died and left 12 children, lo aleinu, the widow doesn't know what to do. We're not millionaires, what are we going to do? If we have to send a dollar to each one of these envelopes, this is our entire income. So what are we going to do? So we're to help the whole world, it's not realistic, we don't have. So what do with these envelopes? A big crime. We take them as they are sealed, we see the headline, right to the garbage. And I saw a big chacham wrote, if you are a kosher Jew, you open, you read it, you read about this widow or this yeshiva that chas v'shalom may be closed tomorrow, and you cry a little bit, or your heart is aching, and you read 2 or 3 prakim of Tehillim, that's a chesed, that's mitzvah. Okay, I didn't send you money, but I read 3 prakim Tehillim for you. I thought, I put it in the garbage. Lock his door, nobody can knock. Tell us, I'm not home. All year, I'm not home. I'm not home. You see me, but I'm not home. You understand? This is it. This is now the time. If not now, Be'ezrat Hashem. Any questions about more specific? I know it's hard for me to know when you choose a topic what you really mean. You spoke something about the elections, something about this. I don't really think that we should care about so much about the elections. Anyway, Hashem runs the world. He puts a puppet in the middle of the pyramid and he moves him left and right. You understand? You do ishtadlus. If the Rebbe thinks that it's good to go and vote for someone that is maybe good for the community, for the Jews, fine. With or without voting for him, if we need something, Hashem will give it to us. If not, you know, when Obama got elected, everyone went panicking here. I saw the faces of the people, like the end of, like Arafat became the president of America. That's how people looked. And I said, what do you think is worse than Carter or Clinton? Clinton, the lover of Israel, made us the biggest damage. And Bush, which announced that he loved Israel very much, and is very pro-Israel, and this and this and that, made us the biggest damage. Half of all this area of Gush Katif and all these places, he gave it to the Hamas because of his pressure. All these lovers of Israel, they make us bigger damage because they sit with us and fool us in a political way. Give them. It's important, give them. If you know that it's dangerous, it's different because there's really no cooperation so much. But in the end, is he worse than all the other presidents? No, Hashem moves him. He started bad, now he's not as bad anymore. He became quiet already, you know? He gave up. He's not really making damage. It's all in the hand of Hashem. You care, this one, that one, this one. And the taxes, they continue to rise. Someone told me yesterday in Queens that he owned a lot. One lot. He used to pay $800 taxes on a lot in Queens. They raised it to 2,000 and a month later to 8,000. Do you understand what happened here? In a matter of months, from 800 to 8,000 taxes on an empty lot. He said, anyway, I cannot do anything with this lot. Can't build. I build, I cannot sell. Nobody will buy. To build will cost me more than to sell. And now they're choking you from all over. You say, okay, I won't make profit. No, my friend. It's not enough for us. We want you to lose. Look what's happening here. Every year they raise the taxes 12%. What happens in the end? The annual tax would cost more than to buy a house here. Think about it. That's the end. One way or the other. Forget for a second Mashiach. Forget all the horrible things that is about to happen any minute. If the world supposedly was in a quiet, peaceful situation, just the way we are heading into this situation, people would have to kill each other for food. You know, this goyim, they're going to make riots. You know, I heard they're raising the Varazano Bridge to $17. They raised the George Washington to $12. Right. Yeah, a person wants to drive to Queens, he's paying $60 gas and tolls. Think about it. And he's going to get to the job, and they're going to pay him $75, $80. And from that, they take taxes. So in the end, he paid $10 out of his pocket to go to work. You're laughing. That's exactly happening right now. You understand what's happening? One way or the other, HaKadosh Baruch Hu closed from all directions. And the tie is getting tighter by the minute. One way or the other. It's a no-win situation. Only en lanu al mi lismoch al avinu shebashamayim. For all the people who didn't do real tshuva, only half, now it's the time to complete their tshuva. For those who started very high and slowly, slowly became business people and went down and down and down, now it's time to go back to the childhood days. We used to be in cheder, all day Torah, irat shamayim, watching your eye. Now it's the time. If not now, when?